Amen. Amen. I want to encourage everybody to please take out your Believe books if you brought them from home. Let's hold them up. All right. Looking forward to the day that all I see is a sea of these books. Why? Because this is God's Word arranged in 30 key chapters, 30 key ideas that's coming from God's Word. The Bible teaches us to both believe, to be doing, and to be in Jesus Christ. So think, act, and be more like Jesus. The first five chapters we learned were focused to inform our relationship with God, or this vertical relationship, which is where it needs to start, right? Because we were created by God for God. Amen? For His glory. So that's where everything started. And then, you know what? Actually, let's pray right now. Let's turn to God. Lord God, our focus is on You. Because You are our life. You are our God, the giver of every good and perfect gift, even Your Son, Jesus Christ. We need You. We need Your inspiration. We need You, Lord, to lead us through, Lord, the passages of each week. Lord, to move these truths deeper into, Lord, from our heads into our hearts and into our lives, into flowing out, Lord, that more and more we are like You as You desire, conform to the image of Your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray, amen. Amen. Well, next we looked at chapters 6 through 10, which is focused horizontally to inform our relationships this way with one another, with this world. And in chapter 6, we learned the answer to this key question: how will God accomplish His plan? Please say this with me. I believe the church is God's primary way to accomplish His purposes on earth. So if you are a Christian, if you've given your life to Jesus, you are a part of the church, this movement, this body that's called the church. Chapter 7, we tackled this key question: how does God see people? And this is what we discovered. Say this with me. All people are loved by God and need Jesus Christ as their Savior. So because this is how God sees people, this is how we see people. They are loved, and so we love them. And they need Jesus, and so we share Jesus with them. All right, that was chapter 7. 2 weeks ago, we worked our way through this key question: what about the poor and injustice? And the biggest thing that we learned that week, say this with me, I believe all Christians are called by God to show compassion to people in need. So this must be a priority for us if we are serious about our relationship with God. Now we tackle our next key question from chapter 9. You can turn with me to page 142 if you have your Believe books. And the key question there is, what is God's call on my life? What is God's call on my life? And the answers begins with the key passage also listed right there from Psalm 24 verses 1 to 2. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For He founded it on the seas and established it on the waters. What's all that business about the waters and on the seas? Well, that's hearkening back to Genesis chapter 1. Remember, the Spirit of God hovered over the waters. And God spoke, let there be light. And there was light, right? And God spoke, let there be land, dry land appear, and there was land. Okay, so this is talking about how God created all of it with His Word. It came into being. It is all from Him. It all belongs to Him. And not only the earth, but everything in it, everything on it, everyone in this universe belongs to God. So, all who live in it, it all belongs to God. So the first step in discovering your calling, you know, what God's calling you to do, the first step is to have a spiritual transaction with God concerning ownership. All right? And this is in our key idea for this week. I believe everything I am or own belongs to God. All right? To come to the realization, God, it all, everything I am, everything I own belongs to God. And you say, okay, God, you purchased me. In the words of the Heidelberg Catechism, what is the greatest comfort in life and death? That I am not my own, somebody say it, that I am not my own, but I belong in life and in death to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. Somebody said, Heidelberg Catechism, what's that? By the way, the Reformed Church has this teaching. It's called the Heidelberg Catechism. I encourage everybody to get a copy. It's excellent, all right, on the doctrine of the church. But that's the key. We belong to God. And so you say, God, you purchased me through what you did on the cross. You created me. I give it all back to you. I belong to you. Come into my heart. I leave the throne of my heart. I'm no longer in charge of my life. You, I belong to you, so you're in charge. I am yours. It's all yours, Lord Jesus Christ. All right? So when you do that, here's what God does. He says, thank you. And then he gives it back to you, not to own as if it's your own, okay, but to steward. He gives you back your life. He gives you all your stuff back. I mean, when you say you surrender it to him, he gives it all back. He says, I've placed it in your care for your management. It is mine because you have rightly given it back to me. All right? But I make you steward over it for my purposes. That's amazing, is it not? Yeah. You know, here's something. Write this down that comes from our passage and from this chapter. God doesn't really need what we have. Think about that. God doesn't really need what we have. So our giving must be for our sake. You're like, what? Really? Okay, let's look at Psalm 50. All right, it's on page 145 of your believe. It's also on page 105 of your student edition. All right, now I'm going to read the bold section there. This is God speaking. He says, I have no need of a bull from your stall or of goats from your pens. For, by the way, what's with goats, right? And what's with bulls? Those were things that people offered in worship, in the sacrifices, in the temple, okay? So they gave that, all right? I have no need of them. For every animal of the forest is mine, and the cattle on 1,000 hills. I know every bird in the mountains, and the insects in the fields are mine. If I were hungry, I would not tell you, for the world is mine, and all that is in it. Do I eat flesh, the flesh of bulls, or drink the blood of goats? The assumed answer there is, of course not. All right? So God is saying, I don't need what you're giving. Well, then why does God ask us to give tithes? And why does God ask us to give offerings and things out of what he has given to us? Why does he do that? Well, it's because he loves us. Right? And he is at work, and he wants to include us in his work. All right? And it's a wonderful thing. Just the other day, I was talking with my nephew, and he was saying, Mark, I've been experiencing this where I'm taking the step of following the Holy Spirit's prompting, and I'm giving some of my time to help this guy out and to share with him. And I experience the Spirit using me, and that guy, wow, it's awesome. That's what it's about. He doesn't need us. If we're not willing to be a part of what he's doing, he's willing to. He's got the cattle on 1,000 hills. He's got people all over the place that he can use. Amen? And can work through. But he invites us to be a part of it. So it's for us. The outline of chapter 9 in this Believe book is very simple. God is the owner. We are his managers. We are the managers. Now, one of the most instructive passages on this theme is Matthew 25, and it's on page 146 of your Believe books or page 106 of your student editions. And let me just read a little bit. Jesus is telling this story, and he's going to outline three very important principles in management, for we are managers of what he's given us. And this section begins with again. Now, whenever you hear the word again, that means that Jesus has just told another story, and now he's telling a new one. He says, again, so whatever he just said in the former story, he's going to underline and drive even more deeply, right? It's the same idea, the same application. And actually, if you read all of it, you find out that Jesus tells a third story after this one, and he starts again. So he's like, I want you to get this. I want you to get this not just here, but down here. So I'm going to tell three stories to underline this point. All right, so let me read. Again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his wealth to them. To one he gave 5 bags of gold, to another 2 bags, and to another 1 bag, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. Now, in this story, Jesus is referring to himself. Jesus is the owner. He's the one that has gone on a journey, right? He came the first time. He died. He rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven. All right? So he's gone on a journey. And notice he's left his people that belong to him. He's left them gifts of gold. It says they're his wealth, right? So just because he's gone away doesn't mean that, and he gave him these gifts, these bags of gold, doesn't mean that those bags of gold were theirs. It's his wealth, right? Also underline the part that says each according to his ability. Each according to his ability. You know, consider this guiding principle, and you're welcome to write this down. There's extra space in your bulletin on the back page. Just, you can write this down. God is not asking us to accomplish great things, but to be faithful to invest what he has given us for him. All right? So God is not asking us to accomplish great things. You're like, what do you mean? Well, not great things by the world standards. All right? As we would measure success. That's not what God's looking for. He's looking for faithfulness with what he has given you. So some of us might be thinking, you know, I'm a little disappointed at this point in my life. I don't know how much time I have left, and I haven't changed the world yet. Well, that's not the question. The question is, with what God has given you, have you been faithful to use it for him in this life, right? You know, take an inventory. What has God given you? What things, what experiences in life, you know, what stories to share? What has God given you? What abilities and talents? How much influence in other people's lives? What has God given you, and what have you done with what he has given you in this life? You know, some people God has given the ability to wield a hammer and construct things. How many know that's not my ability here, right? Yeah, Kimberly knows. You know, not mine. All right? You know, some of you have been given the ability to fix things like cars. You know, I am in awe of you. That's not my ability, right? But some of you would die if you were asked to come up here and give a message, right? Each has different gifts from God according to their ability, right? And you know, some of you have been given big bank accounts. Some of you not so much. That's okay. That's not the focus here. Some of you have been given a IQ to rival Einstein's. Some of you don't know what IQ means. Or as one might say, some of you know DQ, right? But God can use that. He uses what He's given you. And that's what He's focused on. Amen? Use what God has given you for Him in this life. Having more is not what matters. What matters is that you're taking what He has given you and you're investing it in His purposes, His service, His glory. All right, we're going to keep reading. We're up to verse 16 there. The man who had received 5 bags of gold went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 bags more. So also the one with 2 bags of gold gained 2 more. But the man who had received 1 bag went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received 5 bags of gold brought the other 5. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 5 bags of gold. See, I have gained 5 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. The man with 2 bags of gold came. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 2 bags of gold. See, I have gained 2 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. So the master returns to check on his servants and what they are doing with the resources that he had given them. Now, this is referring to Jesus' second coming. Right? He has gone away. He is coming back. And every single person is going to have to give an account to Jesus. So this is the second coming. He's the first two guys, they took what was given them and they doubled it. Again, it doesn't matter how much was given. What matters is what you do with it, right? They were given what they could manage according to their ability. And they each doubled what they were given. Now consider that a little bit. Jesus says to them, you have been faithful with a little, I will give you more. You know, let's look at it this way. God may not give us more because we have not been faithful with what we have now. That stings a little bit, right? But it's true. It may just be that the Holy Spirit is whispering through this passage and saying, if you want me to give you more, then you need to be faithful with what I have already given you. But there is more to the story than just receiving more from God, right? There is this. When Jesus returns, Christians will be judged by Jesus. Not judged for their sins. Right? The Bible is clear that our sins have been paid for by Jesus there on the cross. Right? So we, as believers in Him, depending upon what He did for us, we escape the white throne judgment that the Bible talks about. Okay? But there is a judgment that is reserved for us who belong to Jesus. It's talked about in 2 Corinthians 5, 9-10. Let me read this to you. So we make it our goal to please Him, whether we are at home in the body or away from it. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each of us may receive what is due us for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. So every follower of Jesus Christ will one day stand before Him upon His return, and we will give an account for what we have done with what He has given to us in this life. And if we have produced used our lives and all that He has given us, entrusted to our care for Him, well, then we have reserved a blessing from Him. Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into my happiness. And He gives even more. He says, to you who have been faithful with a little, I will give even more. You can consider that your divine 401k. All right? If you've heard people say, I'm storing up treasures in heaven, yes, that is a reality. All right? I'm working for the King of Glory now, you know, so that I can see even more. I mean, you know, I'm working for my Lord and to please Him when He returns, that He would be pleased. All right. Now, let's take a look at the third guy a moment, starting at verse 24. Then the man who had received one bag of gold came. Master, he said, I knew that you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid and went out and hid your gold in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you. His master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed? Well then, you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest. So take the bag from him who gave it and give it to the one who has 10 bags. For whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken from them. And throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. One principle that we can definitely say out of this passage is, if you don't use it, you lose it. Right? You ever heard that phrase? It's true. Right? If you don't take what God has given you and use it for Him, you just may wake up one day and find that it's gone. That He's taken it. Whatever it is. So use it now, while you can, for His glory, for His purposes. But the teaching here is even more severe than that. And I got to tell you, it's uncomfortable to talk about. It's a part of this passage that, you know, I don't want to upset anybody. And part of me wants to duck. But I need to be faithful. Amen? I need to be faithful to God's word. And what do we know about the truth? Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Amen? He also says that you shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. So let's look at this very severe, difficult truth, and may it set some of us free, even more free or completely free here this morning, all right, as we look at it. So here it is. Person number three. That person is a person who did nothing with their life for God. They buried what God gave them. This person is like many who we meet today who won't volunteer their faith in Jesus, but if you press them, they'll say, yeah, I'm a believer in Jesus Christ, but they absolutely do nothing for Jesus in any given day. They bury what they do know about Him in the sand. Okay? And this third guy, consider how he sees the master. He sees him as hard. He sees him as mean, right? And the one who harvests where he does not plant. Who does that sound like in our world concerning God? Does that not sound like unbelievers who say, God is mean. He's a cruel God. He's unloving, he's unjust. You know what I'm talking about? Is that not how, what Satan inspires so many people to say about God? Right? It's not true at all. God is love. Amen? Right? So, and God is just. So this guy, what he demonstrates is that he really did not know God, his master. He did not really know his master. And thought ill of his master and refused to serve. his master. In the end, at the judgment, this person is exposed as an unbeliever and does not enter God's eternal kingdom, but instead is cast out into the eternal darkness. Now, just to be clear, we looked in chapter 3 at salvation, and we read so many passages that made it so clear that our salvation is not based on works. Amen? We are saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ and not by works. This is not from yourselves, right? Not by works, so that no one can boast. Amen? So works do not save you. Only the blood of Jesus Christ saves you. But works can reveal whether the Savior is in you. Right? By their fruits you shall know them. Why is that also true? Because when you receive Jesus Christ, there's an exchange that happens. The Holy Spirit is planted in your heart, and you cannot help but live more and more and more for Him. You cannot help but desire. I mean, if the Spirit is in you, He's going to flow out of you in your life. So let me ask this question, and we'll close with this question. Is there enough evidence to indict you as being a Christian? You know, what are you doing with what He has given to you? Is your life about you or about Jesus who is in you? You know, wherever you are still holding on to something as yours, you know, or wherever you're trying to hold on to life as under your control, your power, you are the God of your life. It is time to let that go. It is time to open your hands and say back to the Lord, "My life is not mine, but yours, God. What I've thought of as being mine is not mine. It's yours, God. Oh, come in. Rule this. Rule me. Help me to with everything that you have given me, serve you." Every day, let's wake up and say, "Dear God, what do you want me to do today with this life and all that you have given me?" And he will speak to you. If that's a genuine posture of your heart, he will speak to you. And he will give you assignments. And as you fulfill those assignments, you'll experience his Spirit working through you. And this is what you'll get to hear when Jesus comes back and you face him. "Well done, my good and faithful servant. Enter into your master's happiness." Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Oh Lord, we want to hear that "well done, good and faithful servant" when you return. We do not want to be that servant that hears, "Lord, you worthless servant," and to be cast out. Oh Lord, we do believe. We believe in you. And we now, right now, Lord, renew our commitment. And Lord, we give it all back to you, Lord. All that you have given to us, it's yours. And help us. Help us every day. Oh Lord, when you entrust this stuff to us and life and our abilities, help us every day, Lord, to use it for your purposes, your glory, that we may experience your work and your glory in and through us. We pray these things in your name, Jesus. Amen. Amen.